So first of all, I want to welcome you guys to the call. Obviously, we're in the convenience of your lounge room at home. Some of you are sitting in a high-rise building. Some of you are sitting on a bridge, some strange places, and someone's sitting on a business card, Nicole. Awesome. Look, a bit about today's call. Like, we're talking about maximizing the value of your business. I think it's a pretty critical time for business right now. Anyone who's in Victoria, can I get a show of hands to the people in Victoria? Okay, that's pretty much everyone. Awesome. So we can all whinge about lockdown, right? Because most people around the rest of Australia have no idea about lockdown. They don't even understand what a face mask is. And here we are, you know, stuck in our rooms at home trying to work out how do we survive in business over this sort of period of time. The good news is that if you're here, you're probably still going. The bad news is we don't really know when this lockdown is going to end. So in terms of running a business, right now is an important time to be doing some planning. And you'll notice from the headline of today, maximizing the business value in 2021. A lot of us in Victoria have just decided to make 2020 a year of planning. And what that means is let's use the rest of the year to make sure that 2021 is going to come out of the gates running. So I just want to talk about a few things today, and I'm going to just make sure I can get my chappy, so everyone can see my screen. I feel like I'm a mime at the moment with this thing happening in the background. But a little bit about us, our organization. So Outcomes Business Group, we've been around for 20 years. I started this company in 2000. We've been through the recession that we had to have in 2008. And so we've experienced this before, and I've watched people come through the other end of this quite successfully. To me, I'm curious. Now, we might get people into the chat box. So those guys who run their own business, can I just get a show of hands for those guys who run their own business? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, all of you. Great. Please, in the chat box, why did you go into business? One word. Just to let us know the reason you went into business. One word. Why did you go into business? Flexibility, fun, autonomy. Thank you. I find that when I ask people this question, we get a few different answers, but they usually come into two categories. One is the ability to choose your own hours, and the other one is the ability to make as much money as I like, be my own boss. And the funny thing is that for most people, who's been in business over 5 years, can I get a show of hands for those who've been in over five? Yep. We realize what happens. We go into business with this idea of we're going to have a lifestyle, we're going to choose our hours, and we're going to choose the amount of money we make. And the reality is we probably work harder than we ever did for someone else, and we are willing to take a lesser paycheck than is legal. Right? And that sort of happens because I think sometimes it's a bit like a four-year-old taking a Great Dane for a walk, and the question is who's walking who. So today we're going to be talking a bit about how you get out of that and how you get your business dream back and how you get back on track with growing this business of yours. So I just, one of the things I notice a lot is when we look at people who are in business, there's two models that I see a lot of. One is this one where operations is the big circle because we're flat out all the time doing work. We do a little bit of admin and we do minimal marketing. And one of the reasons we do minimal marketing is because when I ask people, how do you get most of your work? The most common way people get work is through word of mouth, right? Who gets most of their work through word of mouth? Can I just get a show of hands? Okay, once again, nearly a majority of the call. And the reason that happens is because you do a good job, right? But the other reason that people don't advertise is because of this little box that shows up in the middle, which is them. And when we talk about running a business, if the business revolves around your effort, right? It's called working in the business, and it's fine, self-employment. And sometimes it can be highly profitable, but one of the issues with being self-employed is capacity. And what I mean by that is if you get good work, you're gonna be busy and you're gonna say, stop sending me work. I've got too much work. I don't have enough time. Now, that's a great problem to have, but it's not sustainable, right? When we talk about business models moving forward, what we need to be looking at is how do we balance these three rings? How do we make sure that we're spending as much time in marketing, admin, and operations as a business as possible? But the key difference here is where you sit. It's called working on the business versus working in the business. Now, for some people, this is the most productive thing you can possibly do, which is your planning, which is working out which direction you need to go, working out where the money is, working out how to cut costs, working out how to find more profitable clients. And we're gonna talk a bit about how you do that today. Because when we talk about maximizing the value of your business, most of the value in a business is not in the revenue stream, It has to do with the amount of dependence on the owner. So we're going to talk about how you get out of that situation and how you build a value which increases your goodwill within your business. It also helps you understand how you can sort of do not more work, but less work and still get paid the profits. So when we talk about maximizing value today, there's three areas we're going to talk about. The first one is, how do you grow quickly? Now, there is an opportunity that has arisen out of COVID. And some of you guys may be aware of this, but a lot of people aren't, because all they're busy doing at the moment is trying to work out how to batten down the hatches and how to ride through the storm. And the big opportunity we're going to be talking about is, how do you acquire business assets from other people? Because there's people out there that are bleeding. They need help. They need people to come in. They need people to give them some cash. And they're willing to sell things at fire sale prices. So Rob's going to talk a bit about that one. The second thing we're going to talk about is, how do you integrate your communication? Because one of the most valuable assets that does exist within your own business right now is your database, your client base, your prospects, your partners, anyone who knows who you are. And how are you leveraging that communication? And the final part, which is the consolidation part, is what actually has happened in the last 6 months has been phenomenal in terms of how much technology the business owner has applied within their business. I heard it said that it's the equivalent of 6 years of adaption of technology has happened in 6 months. What that means is, it means we've got more leverage. People are using Zoom every single day. I don't believe that will disappear when COVID disappears. I think we will use it as an alternative to travel. I wouldn't want to own an aeroplane right now, because when I look at the options of going to Sydney for a 1 hour meeting or having a 1 hour Zoom meeting, the costs are phenomenally different. So we're going to be talking about how to bolster that up as well. So to get us off, like, let's get this show on the road, I think. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to introduce our first speaker to you guys. Rob Jagger, who's been a coach with us for a while now, probably about 6 years. He's going to be talking about maximizing the value of your business through acquisition. So I'm going to hand over to Rob, and we're going to get him rolling with his presentation. So Rob, over to you.
Thank you, David. Okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Rob Jagger, and I'm a business coach, but also acquisition strategist at Outcomes. And welcome to Maximizing Your Business Value Through Acquisition. But before we get started, I want to make this as interactive as we can. So do ask questions, put them in the chat box. We do have a Q&A at the end where I'll answer your questions. If not, I'll follow them up later on. So let's start this process by helping me understand who's in the audience. So I want you just to go to the chat box now and just list what industry you are in, whether you're an accountant, a tradie, a physio, or an engineer. Just share with everyone else here what industry you're working in, so we get an idea who's in the room. All right. Now, in these changing environment, it's very hard to predict what to do next. And while some businesses have been able to pivot and found new growth opportunities, others who have relied on old strategies are starting to go into decline, which could be terminal. So now we need to take advantage of all the disruption that's happening in the industries, because there are some bargains out there. And if you're proactive, you might have some good opportunities. All right. Let me just get this working. All right. Before I get started, I want to give you a bit of an idea of my journey to coaching. And it really started with Graham. Now, Graham was my dad's best mate. And he was always the life of the party at our family functions, our barbecues, our picnics. And he always had a glint in his eye as he was going to tell you one of those bad jokes. But the worst possible thing happened to Graham. His health started to fail. Initially, he just had the shakes. But this was diagnosed as Parkinson's. And within 1 year, he was left with no choice but to close down his business. And it always seemed so unfair to me, because Graham had been such a pillar of the society, but the reality is people didn't want to go and see a dentist when they had the shakes. So the key issue for Graham was that he was the center of his business. And so when his health failed, so did his business, because he had no one else to help take direction and move the business forward. So I took it upon myself to help business owners to make their business into something valuable by putting processes and procedures and building a team. All right, let's continue on. There are a number of key growth opportunities now during these turbulent times, and I want to go through three of them in particular with you. And the first one is to actually start a business. This suits an employee who now wants to become the boss. Normally, the entrepreneur has some technical expertise in a particular area, but now what they really need to do is leverage that technical skills with knowledge about running a business and marketing a business. So start off with starting a business. The next option that I wanted to point out is growing your business. And this is suited, obviously, if someone already has a business. And with focus and discipline, we know that you can achieve organic growth. You can get your 5, your 10%, maybe even more percent growth each year. But the path is slow and steady. And the last option I want to take you through is actually buying a business. And this is suited to someone who wants quick results. What happens is you can, in these times now, you can get some, you need to supplement your organic growth with a business growth through acquisition. And that's how you really drive your business forward. All right, let's keep moving. I want to go through each one of these and give you an idea of what I think are the pluses and the minuses. And the first one is starting a business. Now, I think there's some issues there because I think it's highly risky. If you look at the Bureau of Statistics numbers, 60% of businesses fail within the first 3 years. So it's a highly risky option. The second option we have here, growing your business. This is good, but as I said before, it is slow and steady returns. And if you want quick returns, then what I'm suggesting you need to do is looking at buying a business. The risk is low because you're buying something you can review and you can evaluate, and the returns are quick. In fact, what you're getting a chance to do is grab that cash flow from the other business, access the talent from the employees there, look at the products and services they offer and see where they can augment to yours. But also, the best of all, you get all those additional leads and additional customers. All right. A lot of business owners have said to me, is it ethical to be buying a business during the pandemic? Are you just preying on businesses that are unfortunate or distressed? Well, I say to you, if you can find motivated sellers, then it definitely is a win-win result. It's a win-win result because the business owner was going to close down the business anyway. And by you offering them some money, they get to get some money for their business. The employees retain their jobs. The customers continue to be served. All that knowledge that's been generated over the last few years in that business is retained. And last but not least, you have a solid platform to grow from. So really, buying a business can be very ethical, especially when you're working with a motivated seller that's already decided to move on anyway. So what is the size of the opportunity in Australia? Motivated sellers, what does that mean? I'll give you a quick idea. In Australia, there's 2.1 million small to medium-sized businesses. And of those 2.1 million, each year, 6% of them list that they want to sell. They'll go to a broker or they go to online registries and they list their business to sell. But most of those never sell. 80% apparently won't sell. So you'll find that there's over 100,000 of businesses that are motivated sellers but couldn't find a buyer. In addition, each year, 12% of businesses do not close down. Then there's a whole series of reasons we'll look at in the sector why businesses shut their doors. And last but not least, there's the baby boomer generation. They own 50% of all businesses and they're already in their late 50s, 60s and 70s. If you assume that all the baby boomer businesses need to transition in the next 10 years, 10% would be another 100,000. So you see there's several hundred thousand of businesses there where you've got motivated sellers. All right, let's keep going on. So I talked before about why a business would close down. These are some of the reasons. COVID is a key one for us now, because not only is there a whole series of health issues with that, but a business owner needs to be able to navigate through all the changes the government and others are imposing on us. So COVID, your customers could become COVID positive, your employees could, you could. It's a bit of a minefield. Money, retirement, we talked about the baby boomers want to retire.
you're getting burnt out, you need to have a change, your health's failing. There's a whole series of reasons why businesses do close down. All right. So I want to give you a bit of an idea of the multiples that apply to businesses so you get an idea of where the opportunities are. I'm going to start off with what we call an unsophisticated small business. This is where the owner operates it. It really is the owner is in charge and all the communication channels go through the owner. David gave you a good example of that before. Normally they have a 2 to 2.5 times multiple. And what we're talking about is multiple of the net profit of the business. So the business is worth 2 to 2.5 times the net profit. We're going up to the next one, this green area. This is a bigger business. It's professionally managed. So there really isn't the owner running the show anymore. There could be a general manager. There might be an ops manager. There might be a sales and marketing manager. But there's a bit of a team that runs the business. And this normally has a 3.5 to 4 times net profit multiple. If you go to the other side of things, we get into the private equity area, it can be a 10 times multiple. And up the very end here, it can have 20 plus. And that's really for like tech businesses on NASDAQ, etc. So you can see that if you focus on the blue and the green area, there are some capabilities of buying up businesses that you could potentially roll up and then propose for a much bigger multiple later on. All right. Now, one of the key things that I ask business owners to consider is when they buy a business, you want to buy it with minimal out-of-pocket expenditure as you can. You don't really want to spend a hell of a lot of money in that process of acquiring the business initially. So how can you do that? Well, there's a whole series of techniques and tactics that help you. And I suppose the biggest one of those is the whole vendor finance or vendor earnout. If you can get a vendor to give you a period of time, a number of years for which to allow you to pay them back, then you can use the profit of the business to fund that purchase of the business. Another thing you could look at is asset-based finance. All people, all businesses have a range of assets, and some of them you can actually generate money from. You can, if you had a property, you could sell it and lease it back, for instance. And then there's a, just wait, let me go back here. I've stopped for some reason, which I'm not really sure why. There we go. Then we've got vendor equity and key employee equity. This doesn't make much sense, but let me give you a worked example. If you can see here, I've got this plumbing business that has been purchased for a 2.5 times net profit multiple. Now, you probably see on the annual profit line, its profit is $200,000 a year. 2.5 times 200,000 gives that purchase price of 500,000. Now, we've been able to negotiate terms. And the terms we've got is 20% deposit with the 80% balance over 3 years. So if you look up here, you'll probably see that 20% is at sale and then 27% is paid out over each of the 3 years. Now, if you look at the bottom line here, you will see that this deal has a total of $100,000 in your back pocket after 3 years, but you need to fork up $100,000 to start off with to fund the proposal. So it looks okay. You own the business after 3 years and you've got $100,000 in your back pocket at the end of that process. But let's see how we can sweeten that deal. There we go. All right. This is how you sweeten it. If you see here, the first thing we do is a carve out. We had a look at all the assets on the balance sheet and we saw that the owner had a Lexus there worth $50,000 that he was driving around. So we tell the owner that we don't want that Lexus. We carve it out of the deal. So now instead of a $500,000 purchase price, the purchase price is $450,000. So that reduces the amount of money we need for a deposit to $90,000. What else can we do? The next thing we can do is we talk to the ops manager and we offer him 10% equity in the business, $500,000 $1 business, 10% is $50,000. We find another $10,000 in working capital to help fund it. So now we've got a business that we can purchase. We only have to put $30,000 up front. And at the end of 3 years, we have $210,000 in the back pocket. This is because we can use vendor finance to use the actual profit of the business to pay for the purchase of the business. And this is really what you need to look at. All right, now I want to talk about the acquisition team. It's not just one person. You need a few different business professionals to help you when you buy a business. You need a strategist such as myself to help you determine the strategy and help you identify the businesses to buy. You need a commercial lawyer to do commercial due diligence, legal due diligence, but also to write the contract of sale. You need the accountant to do the financial due diligence, but also to normalize the books. And last but not least, you need a lender if you need to borrow some money to buy the business. So you need your acquisition team, really important. Now, I want to take you through a bit of a case study of ours. And this case study is with Valiant Plumbers. So let me tell you about Valiant Plumbers. They had a USP about providing remarkable customer service. And this is really important because they were a disruptor for the general plumbing maintenance business. So, you know, they're the domestic plumbers that come and help you when your toilet's blocked or to put in new air conditioning or whatever. So they wanted to change that. And they knew the biggest issue in that category, in that service provision, was the unreliability of the tradespeople. But also, not only unreliability, they often left things dirty and they weren't prompt and they weren't presentable. So this business really focused on really helping present themselves very professionally. So what did that mean? Well, what that meant is that they originally focused on body corporates and real estate agents. They had no success there, so they pivoted their business to start looking at plumbers to buy. So they started marketing them which plumbers want to sell their business. And within 2 weeks, they found their first candidate. It was a plumbing business where the owner had died 18 months before. There was five plumbers working in the business, but the problem was it was owned by the mother and the daughter and they had no knowledge about the plumbing business. So they thought, fantastic, we've got a chance, we're a motivated seller to sell our business and to move on. So that gives you a bit of an idea of how successful this strategy can be. In fact, they had 8 acquisitions over a 6-year period, and they quadrupled their revenue and quadrupled their profit. So you can see you can buy a small bolt-on business, add it to your current business, and it can really give you a big step change moving forward. Now, I want to just quote Bruce Lee here, because Bruce Lee said, knowing is not enough, you must apply. Being willing is not enough, you must do. So if this resonated with you, what I'm suggesting you need to do is you need to book a 15-minute discussion with me about business acquisition and how it could help your business. We know that there is a lot of businesses, good businesses now, where the owner is now a motivated seller. They want to get on with a new chapter of their life. They don't want to deal with the pandemic. They don't want to deal with a whole series of things. So if you really looking to get some growth in your business besides organic growth, a bolt-on business is great way of moving forward. So what I want you to do is just go into that chat box now and put your name that you want to speak to myself, and we'll organize a catch-up to work out how business acquisition strategy can work for you. All right, then that's the end of that there. I'll awesome, just pop the share.
Let's give Rob a quick hand. Well done.
Thank you.
I love the story, Paul Graham.
Yeah.
But, I suppose, if anyone's thinking of acquisition, the next 3 months in business is going to be awesome time to be looking at your competitors, keeping an eye on what's going on, because some of them are going to need your help. And you're going to get things at wholesale prices. So if you're not thinking about acquisition, you haven't thought about it before, just turn the radar on. because don't assume that just because things are going tough for people that they're not bargains to be had, because business will bounce back. And those people, there's a theory called last man standing. And that means if you're still in an industry when everyone else has fallen over, you'll pick up all of the best workers, all of the best clients. And if you can keep going through this dip that we're having, you're going to come out successful at the other end. So please, if that's something that's of value to you, if you think in the next 5 years you might be acquiring as a quick way to grow, then Rob's your man. What we're going to do now is we're going to do a quick networking session. So we're going to break off into smaller groups with some of the presenters. And just this is your chance to introduce yourself, get to learn about some other people on this call. So we're going to go into we've got small groups. I don't know what the number is going to be. It's going to be a couple of minutes, 5 minutes or so in that group. And then we're going to come back to learn a bit more about how we can integrate communication. So we'll see you back from the break shortly.
David, you got a minute?
Hey, Lorena, you can't play that music because we're getting copyright breaches on it. Hey, look at that. Magic.
All back again.
How good is that?
Very good.
We've even got some new people.
It worked well.
Indeed.
Hey, Gregory, welcome to the call.
Hello. Good morning.
How are you going?
Very well. Thank you. And yourself?
Just in time for our next presenter. Very exciting.
Eldred, hello.
So where are we at? Okay, so did we get some good distinctions out of the breakout room? Did we meet some people? If you had a good time in the breakout room, big thumbs up.
Yeah, it was good. Yeah.
If you hated it, thumbs down. If you're not going to put your thumb anywhere. What I'd like to do is I'd like to introduce our next presenter. So we talk about maximizing value of business. And I think one of the most undervalued part of any businesses are the relationships that you have. And I'm not just talking about clients, because clients definitely have value because they're paying money and we can count that in revenue. But I'm talking about non-converted prospects. I'm talking about past clients, and I'm talking about any partners or any relationships that you have that make your business valuable. Now, one of the things a lot of people aren't doing very well is connecting the relationships and communicating effectively through some central source. So I've asked Raj Kumar to join us today because he's an expert in putting together tech systems that are sort of focused on automation, integration, and making sure that you're building that intrinsic value of that database. Because when it comes to valuating a business, and I know some people thinking, well, I'm not selling, so why do I need a valuation? And I'll suggest that the value of your business is determined by how autonomous your business is and how little it relies on you. So getting your CRM in order is one of the key elements of making sure your business is automated and it reduces the stress on yourself. So I'd like to switch over to Raj. If you'd like to give him a nice warm welcome to the call, let's get him on.
Thank you, David. I guess everyone can see my screen at the moment. Okay. So if everyone just simply tell me by thumbs up, everyone can hear me and everyone can see my screen as well. Yeah, perfect. Thank you. Just continuing from what David and also what Rob said, what we will do is we will just simply start talking about how we can increase the value of the business. Simply, when you're buying a business or when you're selling a business or when you are growing a business, efficiency is the core of everything so that you don't end up in paying unnecessarily. And what we do is we implement the CRM, which is customer relationship management. This can be done in more than one way. One thing that I would like to ask before I will start this presentation is, what is the value of each prospect in your business? By what I mean by value of each prospect, how much that customer is worth to you? If you guys can just drop that message in the chat, we can relate to this one later in the presentation. So for example, to me, maybe our average client might be $5,000. So that's what I want you to drop. Now, who we are and what is it that we do? It's not one person who can do all of it. And so what we are is, yes, our company name and the team name is IT Solution Solved. We started this business in 2012. After working many years in CRM and in technology. Then I was joined by a couple of other team members as well. Now the front of the house is Rob and Peter. These are the function consultants, as you can see on the screen here. Then our functional consultants are supported by our project support, which is Nitin. And then we have the developers who do this. We can call this dirty work, where they do go and they can code, they can do customization. And when this work is completed, then it comes back to the functional consultants to go and train you guys and show you how you should be using the application. So that's kind of a snapshot of our team. We do have, if you even put half of the team, we have more than 45 years experience behind us. Rob himself have worked more than 25 years in CRM. Same is with Peter as well. And I have worked in CRM consulting for nearly 12 years, but in IT itself, 20 years. So you can this is where experience of the team can matter quite a lot. And this is also one more thing I would like to highlight. We also keep how to keep the cost low when we are implementing or when we are delivering the project to you. So we have two sides to it. One is our onshore consulting, which comprises of our team between three of us. Then we have our offshore development. Then we, in this way, we do bring best of both worlds to you. You get to save, we get to save as well. So the cost of the development is reduced significantly because we are getting the development done offshore. So now when we're going to talk about next one, this is something that I will ask you guys as well. How many of you can relate to this, where you have a leaky bucket situation in your business, where you are putting quite a lot of money in advertising, marketing, on your socials, on your other channels as well, whereas you are losing the prospects because you were not able to follow them up, or you missed it, or maybe you follow it up, but there was not enough nurturing was done to that lead or to that prospect, and then you end up in losing. This is why I ask what is the value of your each prospect to your business. If you have, for example, $500 average value, and even if you lose one prospect in your business in a month, then your business is paying nearly $500 a month. Whereas implementing these businesses, the implementation cost is sometimes once off, but the software subscription cost, they are as low as $50 in some cases. Yes, different businesses will need different kind of CRMs, different kind of softwares. So even by paying $50 and putting this work in place, you can save quite a lot. So that's cost to value that we're talking about. But the second part is, can these systems help you in saving from this leaky situation? Yes, they can. What else these systems can do for your business? They can improve the engagement. So what I would do is I will show you an example here where I'm going to post the link inside in the chat itself. And what I would do, I'll get to visit this page and I will want you to go and visit this page in here. I lost it, I think. Okay, so are you guys still with me? Yes, I hope so. Yep, okay. So what happens here is, from this leaky situation, by improving the engagement, because whatever the marketing you have done, whatever advertising you have done, you attracted that prospect or attracted that contact. The very next thing that you can do is you can start decoupling your sales process. And this is how the CRM systems can help you, by increasing the awareness, by creating these follow-ups, by automating some of the business process where you can just simply create the clone of the existing proposal template, by providing a 360 degree view of your client, that how they came in contact with you. Then another team member can pick up on it as well, and this is how these systems can provide a better team collaboration. And very next to it, then we start talking about, yes, this is a very complex journey. And I don't think I will hesitate in saying that when somebody comes in contact with you, they don't make this decision to buy from you straight away in their first interaction. They're going to try to measure you up as well, your business as well, whether you have the capacity to deliver or not. And this is what you can do. The systems can help you as well in guiding through this process of going one part where they just attracted, and from to the other side of it where they are ready to purchase from you. Whether you have just engaged them, whether you have started nurturing them, whether you have started providing the information what they need to make the decision to buy. And these systems can help you in in streamlining all this. So next one is, can these systems help you doing more than what we just talked about? Yes, they can. Automations are creating those follow-up tasks and sending those reminders to your prospects as well. Bringing the data from your socials. And I guess I don't have to say it, but everyone knows this thing now, that these days amount of social interactions that's happening with your business is just skyrocketed. And bringing that information in your system can add a lot of value. The next thing to this one is better decision-making, both from your side as well as your client's side as well. So these softwares can help you in increasing this information for you. Can they make it easy for you and your client as well? Surely they can. If these systems are implemented in the right way, you can even make the decision, or your client can end up in making that decision by sitting in the car. Or yes, I will not say whether they are driving. Yes, when they have gone out somewhere or sitting in a cafe somewhere, they can check whether, yes, you have sent the proposal. They can sign that proposal from the phone. And that proposal can come back into the system and you can simply initiate your onboarding process afterwards. So these systems does help you in making this transition just from knowing the customer, knowing your business, to making to the stage that you are ready to purchase. Very next thing that I would like to mention after this is, what is it these other people or other businesses who have interacted with us, what do they think? These are the live client reviews that I would like to post it here. In some of the cases, they went into the level that they started writing that, yes, it was a great value in knowing us and having that 45 minutes. This is what Martin Birch wrote it. Very next to it is the Darren West. He had only one session with us, and we were able to guide him what will be the best solution for him. This was the client who we did not even end up in taking it with us. We just simply did a 45 minutes review of his journey, advised him, and then he went his way. Then we had the clients who end up in buying the session with us. We did a bit of a work for them as well. And we did end up in getting this beautiful, lovely review from them where they wrote that we delivered more than what they have even paid for, and they highly recommend us. So exactly the same thing that I would like to request from you as well. If you are not sure where you are in your CRM journey for your business, we can offer you 45 minutes obligation-free consult. All you have to do is in the chat message, just drop a message that yes, you will like to hear from us, or you can send a message to us and we will get into touch with you. So thank you for your time. We do appreciate that you come online.
Thanks, Raj. Give Raj a bit of a hand. And if you're listening, if you're not, we know you're not. Awesome. So obviously CRM, it's a technical area of business, but I think these days without a CRM, you're letting things slip between your fingers. You had a great image on there of the bucket with the holes. And too many people that I've met, you know, they've got a great marketing strategy, or they've got a great engagement strategy when they meet people for the first time. But those people who don't buy straight away, what are you doing to make sure that that relationship's continuing? And the social media side of things is becoming more important now than ever. So if anyone is interested in finding out more about CRM, Raj is super technical and he's brilliant at it. So please get in touch with him if you need that help. We're going to go into another mixed breakout room. This time we're going to try and change it up. So hopefully you meet some new people. Please make sure you do network with these people. There's some great people on this call that probably should be doing business with each other. So I'm going to get Lorena to switch us into some breakout rooms for a couple more minutes. And then we're going to be back to talk about security and how you put this all together on a safe platform to grow your business. We'll see you in a few minutes.
You're back.
All back.
Look at that. Hey, happy cruise. There's smiles on faces, which is awesome. Just going to go straight to our next presenter. So, look, I think the importance of value of business is integrity. And one of the things that's happened, we've all been forced into this working from home. And what we haven't realized we've been doing at the same time is opening ourselves up to the world in terms of access to our data, access to our information, the safety of our content, the safety of our databases. And so we've gone just with whatever we could do to get working online. Our next presenter, James Bomford, has been talking about IT since he was born. I think he was born in front of a computer because he's quite tech. But he's going to be talking about the whole notion of how do you make sure that you've got your integrity of data all the way through this. Because even if we do go back to work one day, which is a promise that may or may not happen this year, this online working remotely is just going to be a part of business moving forward. You know, a friend of mine yesterday I was talking to, he said, you know, Zoom is not a telecommunication program. It's a mode of transport and it's going to be competing with aeroplanes. And so they're going to be challenged to get people to fly to Sydney for 1 hour meetings after this. So let's talk about how we can get some security into your IT system. I'm going to introduce James to the call. Give him a nice warm welcome. Hey, James.
Thank you so much. Let me just bring up the slideshow. All right. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. So I realized sort of in primary school and secondary school that I had a knack for IT. So it was not quite since I've been born, David, but certainly at an early age. And in secondary school, I figured out that I was quite good at hacking. So I was able to hack the school networks multiple times to gain access to various data throughout the network, to the point where every teacher was advised to let the IT department know if they saw me on any of the computers. And I was only allowed to use one computer that was outside the IT department, and I had to be supervised at all times. So I really, I got a great feeling for IT and being able to get around systems as well. So I thought that I wanted to get into forensic science, but end up moving more into technology. So I studied at Swinburne Uni. But I also got a job at Amcor. So I helped them with their IT side of things and developed my skills from that point of view and moved on to various projects within these companies. And while I was there, I actually would help out the directors or the management team or whoever it was. And they'd say, oh, can you come round to our place and, you know, help with my home computer or hook up our network or, you know, clean all the viruses off or whatever it was at that stage. And I would get a bottle of alcohol or something along those lines, which was lovely. I don't drink too much and I still have a lot of those bottles in the cupboard, but it made me think, oh, maybe I could start my own business and actually get paid with real money rather than alcohol. And so I started to do some work on the side until 2010 when I broke away from corporate. 2005 when I broke away from corporate and moved into trying my own way in consulting and IT systems and helping out home businesses and that sort of thing. And I partnered with another gentleman and we built RightClick IT. And after 18 months, I ended up buying him out and he moved on to a different different company. And I've been running RightClick IT ever since then. So we were early adopters of the cloud. And so we really pushed a lot of our clients to move to cloud-based systems because we saw the value of someone else's hardware. And that's pretty much all the cloud is it's someone else's computer. So someone else manages, you know, all the really mundane stuff that can really break a small business, having a server, having software that needs updates, all of this sort of thing is now handled by another vendor. So you're putting your trust into their hands. And what happens is that they spend millions and billions of dollars on research and development and on contingency plans. So they've got multiple internet connections so that you know you If one internet connection goes down, you still have access to your data. And these sorts of systems that they put in place outweigh the cost benefit for a small and medium business. So that's where we really benefit from having the G Suite apps side of things, or the Office 365, or Amazon Web Servers, or Microsoft Azure servers, et cetera, because it gives you that power that you wouldn't want to have as a small and medium businesses. So I won't go too much into the cloud. I think you understand sort of, or most people understand what the cloud is nowadays. It's pretty much when you're using software as a service, so your Gmail or your Hotmail or your Outlook.com, your Office 365, OneDrive, Dropbox. It's all cloud-based systems, Xero, QuickBooks Online. It's really someone else's computer, someone else is managing that data for you, and you're utilizing that as a service. So some of the risks when moving to the cloud. So because of COVID-19, what we've seen is a lot of businesses really move to the cloud quite quickly. I know David at the start mentioned that, you know, we've got 6 years worth of technology that we've jammed into the last 6 months to try and move our businesses to better systems or systems that can enable us to work from home. But the thing is that we've neglected some of the security aspects. And so what we've done is we've said, all right, we need to move swiftly. We need to be agile. We need people to work from home, and we just need to do it quickly. So people have gone to Office Works and they've got laptops that have got Windows Home on them rather than Windows Pro. So you don't have encryption. So that means that the data isn't safe if the device is lost or stolen. It's little things like that that because of the rush, we've missed that we now need to sort of focus on and say, all right, we need to protect our data and we need to make sure it's safe. The other thing is that what we've seen with some of our clients is that there's been some terminations of employees, and it's really hard to get that hardware back, and it's really hard to get that data back. So you're having to sort of backpedal to try and retrieve that hardware or retrieve that data, so that that employee doesn't then move to the next company and take that data with them. So with the systems that we put in place and we help businesses with, it means that we just, they call us and they say, oh, look, we've terminated this employee and we need all of their devices wiped of company data. And so we just push a button and all of those devices are completely wiped. So they're just standard hardware, and the company can get that hardware back in their own time, but they know that that data is safe and that no one's getting into those systems. At the moment, a lot of people are sitting on their hands because they're having a rest, because they're exhausted. COVID has really mentally exhausted a lot of people, and because of that, we haven't got the energy to focus on security, and that's where we just need to step up and engage someone just to help out a little bit, even if it's doing things like putting multi-factor authentication. You know, when you log into a system with a username and password, you have to enter that extra code that's either sent to your mobile or is on a mobile app. Even if we do that with some of our systems, that's one step in the right direction to really assist businesses. I'll talk a little bit about passwords. So we use a password management system, and the reason we use a password management system is so that we can put in random passwords for various systems, so that we don't have the same password for everything, because that's one of the biggest issues is that if one system is hacked and they get that list of passwords, they're going to try that password on pretty much any system possible. So there was a breach of LinkedIn where they took a whole lot of passwords, and pretty much a lot of people had those passwords for various systems. They were able to log into Google Drives, to Dropbox, to 365 systems, because everyone had the same password. There's a really cool skit, actually. Michael McIntyre, he's a comedian, and he talks about passwords, and he says, well, back in the day, we would just have one password, and you put that password in, and it would usually be all lowercase. But then they brought in some security, and they said, all right, we have to have a capital letter. And so everyone went, well, I'll just put the capital letter at the very start of my password. And then, you know, a little while goes along and they bring in a little bit more security and they go, you've got these new things called special characters and we need to implement these special characters. And so what happens is that everyone goes, well, I've got an exclamation mark. I'm just going to put an exclamation mark on the end of my password. So a lot of passwords out there are the same password that you had before, but with a capital letter at the start and a exclamation mark at the end. So what we need to do is we need to really push for people to go with random passwords. So 43% of cyber attacks are aimed at small business because they're easy targets, and 14% of them are not ready. So there are a couple of websites that I'll post in the chat after I finish my presentation that you can go to. You can check if your email address has been released and or hacked, and you can sort of check to see which systems it's been hacked from, and your password. You can actually put your password in and see if it's a vulnerable password. So there's some good tools there. I'm almost finished. So a lot of the systems that we put in place have various bubbles around them. So it means that they're protected, like your systems are protected so that you can only use them on authorized computers. So it means even if a hacker does have your username and password, they still can't log into these systems because of the security that we put in place. We need to stay ahead of the game. So even if you've got an IT provider or even if you've got someone that looks after your IT, you need to make sure that you are protected. So we really need to push for people to do audits and check on your systems to make sure that they're secure, safe, and that no one's getting in. So it's good to have an independent audit of them just to be on the safe side. And as I mentioned, here are some of the systems that we use. And so to help businesses, because we really want to increase that 14%, we really want to make sure that more businesses are protected. We used Dropbox Business, Microsoft 365 Premium, HelloSign, which is the signing software, which is actually built into Dropbox Business now, and 1Password as the password management system. And we can get access to these for a 60-day trial. So if you are interested in really moving to a really good cloud-based system that does give you the security and it's all bundled in with these systems, we can give you a 60-day trial of those. And I'm really happy to do a 60-minute chat with you over the phone or Zoom or WebEx or Teams or whatever system you use to look at the systems that you currently have to say, all right, here are your vulnerabilities and here's where you need to improve. And that's a complimentary audit that we can do. So thank you so much for being patient with me.
Awesome. Thanks. Give James a hand. You didn't guess our password today. Last time he did this, he guessed my password while he was talking, and I had to change it while he was talking. So be weary. When you use capital letters and exclamation marks and the number one, James knows your number. look, we're coming towards the end of today's presentation, but before we go, one of the most important things for me about you investing an hour with us today is making sure you don't walk away and say, that was great, I learned a few things. I would like you to just quickly go through any notes that you've taken during this presentation, and I want you to just identify one or two top takeaways that you've had out of today's session. And if you could just pop them into the chat box. So one or two takeaways out of today's session into the chat box. I'm going to give you about 30 seconds to do that. What did you get out of today's session? Let's go. And while we're waiting, I'm going to put up a fantastic quote if I can get my computer to do this. Doo-doo. And for those who don't know who this guy is, James Rohn. He died, unfortunately, about 15 years ago. But if anyone remembers audio cassettes and CDs, this guy used to be a business philosopher. And one of my favorite quotes, and I picked this up when I was about 21, was never wish life were easier, wish you were better. I think right now with COVID, one of the issues that we have is that it's impacting how we think, how we behave, how our clients think and how our clients behave. One thing we have to learn is what we can control and what we can't control. We cannot control what's going on outside of our in our world. What we can control is how we respond to these things. So working on your sort of attitude, working on your skill set, working on your business is one of the keys to success. And I highly recommend that you start thinking about how can I improve myself, my organization during these times? Because when things release and things open up again, it's those people that are actually planned, they're going to get out of the game. While we're waiting, we've got some comments coming in. Great. We like some graphics. Definitely think I need to thank my password, change my password. knowing is not enough, but action is required. Thank you, Farmash. I need to change some of my passwords. That's come up a couple of times. All right. The security thing has scared a few people. Look, one last thing before we go, and I do want to talk about building businesses, because between now and Christmas is a crucial time for thinking, for strategizing, for making sure 2021 doesn't replicate 2020. There's three phases to building a business. The first one is getting out of chaos. If you're finding yourself working 40 hours plus a week, just trying to make ends meet and just trying to keep up with the workload, chances are you're stuck in your business. Now, you cannot get out of your business until you gain control back. Remember, the four-year-old taking the Great Dane for a walk, the question is who's walking who? Once we've done that, then we can grow. There's no point growing a business that requires you in the center of it, because all you're going to do is paint yourself into a corner and you're going to risk burnout, right? So get control back first, then start growing the business. And the final thing that you need to be thinking about is how do I leverage my time? How do I leverage myself? Now, don't do that until you're growing, because leverage requires cash. And that means employing people, that means systemizing your business, and that means expanding. Okay, so acquisition that Rob's talked about, you know, if you're in chaos, acquisition is not a safe bet. If you're now in control, you are growing, and you actually are looking for ways to shortcut the growth. So rather than going organic and looking at things like marketing and advertising, acquisition is a brilliant strategy because it's a fast track. Okay, when we're talking about growth, we talk about what Raj was talking about, which is CRM. You know, CRM is about moving from chaos to control. It's about having a system to follow. Making sure your IT is working streamlined and fluently is about control. So these are the foundations of growing the business. So there's three phases: chaos to control, then we can go into growth, and the final phase is leverage. Now, for those of you that are interested, just as I finish up, we run this event called the Business Adaption Plan, and we've actually tuned this up for COVID. And what we talk about is, because people, the word pivot has been used a lot. I'm not a fan of pivoting businesses, because what that means to me is changing direction. To me, adaption is about taking what you have and being nimble. One of the most powerful things a small business has is the ability to notice what's happening and move with the times. So if you do not have a business plan that has been changed since COVID, if you don't have a business plan that's going to accommodate moving through the other end of this, you can come to this event. Now, it says $97 on there, but if you're on this call and you're interested in coming to the Business Adaption Plan, just put adaption into the chat box and we'll organize a free ticket for you. First question is, you have to be available on Thursday next week for 2 hours. It's at 3 o'clock, it's for 2 hours. And we're going to show you how to build a business plan that will take you through the end of the year and give you a kickstart to 2021. So anyone interested in that, let us know through chat. You can contact Lorena. Or you can just sort of jump on. Well, if you jump on the website, you'll have to pay. But if you let us know through this communication, you'll get a free ticket for it. What I want to do is I do want to wrap up by just talking about the presenters and to the presenters. And first of all, acknowledging that they've contributed a lot to today. So let's give the presenters a nice appreciation and a nice thank you into the chat box. You can say, thanks, James, for knowing my password. I think a few people have done that. Please feel free to reach out to these guys after the call. I want to really thank you for your attention as well. I know there's a lot going on in most people's worlds, and to get you to concentrate on this screen for an hour and a bit without having to have a bathroom break is tough, right? Thanks so much for your time, guys. Really appreciated having you here. Any questions, if you want to sort of get to the presenters on the chat, we're going to be around for a few minutes, but other than that, enjoy the rest of your day.